series. Good morning, everyone. It's great to be together this Sunday morning. It's turning out to be a beautiful day. It's always great to have the sunshine to lift our spirits when we come in for worship. Hear this from Psalm 24. The psalmist says, "Who is this King of glory?" The answer is, "The Lord, strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O you gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in." Let's stand together and let's open our hearts and our souls to Jesus Christ and to allow the God to enter into us through his Spirit today as we worship him, the King of glory. Take a moment while you're up. Welcome those around you. Introduce yourself to somebody new, and then we'll continue in song.
Holy is he. sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat.
Let's sing that again.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Hallelujah. Can we say thank you, Jesus, for the words that we just sang with all of our heart? Thank you, Jesus. Let's pray, shall we? Heavenly Father, we do come before you and we say thank you for the assurances that we have in your word that you are here and you are alive and you are working in all of our lives this morning. Lord, you are so interested in every detail in every one of our lives. So, Lord, we commit them to you today, our details, our plans, expectations, and even dreams. Father, open our eyes to you. Help us to seek you and give us the courage to follow you with everything that we have. For we love you and we commit this day to you again. For we pray this in your Son's name, the Messiah, Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. And the church said, amen. Amen. Good morning. May you know the love of the Father, the grace that is found in the gospel of Jesus Christ and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. May you know that today and forevermore. While you remain standing, will you please recite with me the words of our Apostles' Creed? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and Jesus Christ, the only Son, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the universal Christian church, the communion of believers, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. A couple of announcements I'd like to share with you before we go into our time of prayer. A couple of Sunday updates that we're not able to make it into the yellow prayer insert. Arnie Teasman, after a couple of episodes over the last number of months, he is having a pacemaker implantation surgery this morning. He was brought into the hospital yesterday and spent the night there, still waiting on the time for surgery, but please keep him and the entire family in your prayers. Also, a celebration of Faraj Elders. We were praying for him for over a week now, and no question about it, God's hand and his healing was upon Raj as he came from no response in a coma of nearly 60 hours. And he is back to his original state. His sense of humor has returned. So if you know Raj, that's a wonderful trait that he has. He's home and he's doing better every day. So thank you for your faithfulness in praying. We brought this to you last week. Thank you for that. And we have a God who is good all the time, even when we don't understand it, even when we lose a child prematurely, or when our marriages aren't very good in the image of God anymore, or when 28,000 people die in a natural disaster. God is still good. So I want to encourage you, church, to continue to pray for those that are in the faith on the other side of this world, but also for those that perhaps are going to see Jesus and his men and his women, our brothers and sisters, through this devastation. So we please keep these nations in your prayers as well. Let's go to him now in prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, we want to say thank you for the hope that we have. It's an unending hope. And Father, sometimes there's things in this world that show up that rattle us a bit. And perhaps there's individuals in the sanctuary today, or perhaps tuning in online, where a faith that was once strong is now questioning your goodness and your faithfulness and your steadfastness, and maybe even, Father, some of us, your forgiveness. Father, remind us right now through your word, remind us by your Holy Spirit of your love, of your faithfulness, of your goodness, of your forgiveness that is only found in Jesus Christ. Lord, we are your children. We desire to know you more. And in doing so, things happen in this world. Sicknesses happen. Natural disasters happen. Premature death happens. But Lord, in the middle of it all, you are still good and you are still in control of absolutely everything. Why do they happen? We do not know. But we do trust that your way and your will is perfect. So Lord, for our cares and our concerns, we lay them all before you. You are our Lord. You are our maker, our creator. You are our redeemer. And so for the cares upon this yellow sheet, for the cares upon our hearts, which we leave unspoken and unshared, Father, meet us there. Meet us where we are today, tomorrow, for the rest of our lives, please. For those that underwent surgeries and treatments this past week, we're mindful of Raj and Phil, Tracy, Adeline, Jenna, Glenda Ward. So thankful he is home, and Cody and Jennifer Van Andel. She still desires, Lord, to know that you are with her right now in a season of loneliness. Lord, we pray for the reports. We pray for the rehab. We pray for strength to return to these individuals' bodies. Give them peace. Give them joy, knowing that they are in your hands and there's nothing that's ever going to separate them from your love. For those coming into procedures this week, Jim and Jake and Darla, Lord, whenever we go and have an evaluation over what is wrong with our physical bodies, it brings anxieties. It brings concerns and hypotheticals of what ifs. Lord, we pray that we are able to lay those down at your feet, to surrender and to trust in you, even with our health, even with our strength, even with a broken heart or a shattered dream. For members of our church that had to lay to rest a loved one yesterday, or the week to come, comfort them, Father. Remind them of the assurance, and this is a beautiful assurance, Father, that when we leave this earth in Christ, we are more alive than ever before. So, Lord, for these families that are experiencing the loss of a loved one, a wife, an uncle, a mom, a grandma, comfort them right now, Father. And as a church, a Christian church centered on your truth, we say thank you for Pastor Sean. We say thank you for the man he is, the spiritual shepherd that he is for this congregation. Thank you for his study, his commitment to you. And Lord, may the words that he shares with us this morning be exactly what you desire for us to hear. May each one impact us, not just for a half an hour, not just for an afternoon, but may the only truth this world has ever known that we hear today, may that be more important than a ball game this afternoon. May that be the most important part of who we are today, this week, and for the rest of our lives. We commit this to you, Father, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to invite the children to come forward for a children's message with Pastor Sean. As they're doing so, if you're new with us, we'd like to know who you are. There's blue cards that are in the pew backs in front of you. Will you please take a moment and fill in maybe a name, contact information, or a specific question that you may have? You can put those in the offering plates as you leave the sanctuary after the service. Also, there's black friendship pads on the outside aisles. Can you please also sign that and slide that down to the rest of the individuals in your row? Thank you.
And as we are waiting for our children to come forward, I want to say thank you, because a number of you have been contributing towards our family fair receipts. Over the last number of years, for every $150,000 of receipts that we turn in, our fellowship youth ministry has received a check for $1,000. This program is coming to an end. And so we have just the next couple of weeks to make a strong push for our last collection of $150,000 of family fair receipts. We're about halfway there. One of our mission partners, Jehovah Jireh Ministries, shared some of their receipts with us as well. So if you have any of those hanging around the house or your neighbor's house or shoved in your purse or your wallet, drop them off at the information desk and help us make that final push. Amen? All right. Boys and girls, you know what to do on the count of three. Ready? One, two, three. All right, this morning, you're not going to be sitting. I need all of you to stand. I need all of you to stand. Okay, can you all stand right there where you're at on that step? And look at me. You're going to do what I do, okay? I want you to make an angry face. Make the angriest face you can. Come on, try it. I need you to make an angry face and put your hands on your hips. Go louder. I need you to stomp your feet. Louder. Okay, stop. How's that feel? That's the wrong answer. No. All right, keep standing. No, get back up, get back up. We're going to try something else. I need you to put the biggest smile on your face that you can. Smile big, smile big. I need you to wave to everybody out here with both hands. Wave, wave at them. I need you to say as loud as you can, I love you. I need you to say as loud as you can, I love you. I need you to say as loud as you can, I love you. All right, everybody be seated. How did you like that first thing that we did? Angry, stomping your feet, hands on your hips for some of you going, do you think that was a very nice thing to do to all these people? Do you think that was nice? Yeah. No, that wasn't nice. Do you think it was nice when we stood up and smiled at them and waved and thought about saying I love you? Do you think that was nice? Yes, you know what? That was nice. God's word tells us that we're not supposed to walk around grumpy and mad and growling like a bear and stomping our feet. Scripture tells us that how we interact with one another, how we treat one another, how we say things, you know what? We have to be gracious. We have to be loving. We have to be kind. And that's what we were trying to do with smiles, with waving. Maybe you give your mom and dad a hug, even saying those words, I love you. Boys and girls, words are important, and how we treat people and how we act towards them makes a difference. So let's be those who say, I love you. Let's be those who are kind. Let's be those who are smiling. Let's be those who share the love of Jesus. Can we do that? Yes?
Yes?
Yes? Let's pray together. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, help us to do that with Jesus in our hearts. Help us to show it on our faces and how we smile. Help us to show it and to share it in how we wave and say hello, in how we hug our mom and our dad or our brothers and our sisters. Help us to say, I love you. Help us to say, I forgive you. Help us to show and to share Jesus in our lives. Thank you for these children. Keep them safe and close to you. We pray it in Jesus' name, as all God's children say, amen. There's no children in worship today, so you can go back to your moms and dads, okay? Thanks for coming up.
Would you please stand with us and let's sing together of Christ alone, of Jesus, you alone, to prepare our hearts for God's word this morning.
Who is the great King of glory, seated on high in the heavens? Oh, Jesus, you alone. You are the Lord God Almighty, strong in compassion and mercy. Jesus, you alone. I search the world for a love that could fill my heart, but nothing compares to the wonder of who you are. Holy, all the earth singing holy, cry holy, Jesus, you alone, Jesus, you alone. You set the stars in the heavens, you set the world into motion.
Holy, all the earth singing holy.
And as you are seated, would you please honor God by taking out a copy of His Word? Maybe you have a device with you this morning. You can pull up on that screen or turn to page 1161 in a Pew Bible. Ephesians 4:29 has become somewhat our main text for these weeks when we are considering miscommunication. When sometimes we get the message wrong, we get the means of communicating God's message wrong. And we've taken the last few Sundays. We'll take this morning. Next week is our last Sunday together in this series. But this morning, we want to take a positive look. Last week was negative. Say that with me. Negative. Last week was all about how we get it wrong. This morning, we want to see how we can get it right. So with God's Word open, let's pray together. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, it is good to have the gift of Your Word. Holy Spirit, thank You that it is inspired, infallible, inerrant. It teaches us all that we need to know for our salvation in Jesus Christ alone. He is the way and the truth and the life. Father God, no one comes to You except through Jesus. Help us to see that truth this morning. Help us to love Your truth this morning. And Holy Spirit, strengthen us in such a way that we do not do it out of obligation, but we do it out of loving obedience for Your glory alone. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. I wonder, as a parent or as a student, what comes to mind when you think about parent-teacher conferences? Most of us have been to a parent-teacher conference. We have those experiences fresh in mind. But I wonder if you've ever gone to one and you've been caught off guard. You thought you knew what to expect until the conference itself began. I understood what parent-teacher conferences were like. I'd been going through them routinely throughout my own experience of elementary school. And now, as a fifth grader, I was convinced that this night was going to be uneventful, that we'd be in and out and back home. I knew what to expect. Having waited our turn, sitting in these little chairs, we were motioned over by Mrs. Kleinhexel. She was ready for us, sitting at her large desk in the back of the room. With my mom and my dad, myself, we exchanged some greetings and some pleasantries. She shared regarding my overall attitude and demeanor and the quality of my work. I was feeling pretty good. This night was right on target to what I had anticipated. Until Mrs. Kleinhexel reached down the lower right drawer of her desk. And as she pulled that drawer open, right there was a math test from that same week. And as she pulled the test out, I noticed that it was decorated beautifully with a large red D plus at the top of the page. That's D as in dog. D plus. Now, not yet 10 years old, I suddenly understood how you develop a stomach ulcer. My throat immediately went dry, and my hands started to get that slimy, clammy feeling to themselves. I prepared for the wheels to fall off the bus, imagining what it would be like to spend yet another year with Mrs. Kleinhexel repeating fifth grade. But you know what followed completely surprised me. Mrs. Kleinhexel was thoughtful. She was direct. Grace with accountability. With a sense of encouragement. With a clear kindness. We talked about the test. We talked about the math problems. She talked about what she believed I was capable of doing. And in the face of me expecting the worst, I left feeling inspired wanting to try harder and wanting to do better. I left feeling and believing that I could. Mrs. Kleinhexel cared and believed in me. You see, there's always two ways of saying something. There's always two ways of expressing something. I want to tell you, you're doing a really good job with your children because they refuse to get mad. Keep that up, okay? We were trying to share how there's two ways of getting a message across, right? There's the first way, which comes across as angry and burnout and put off, and then there's the second way. That's more engaging. That has a certain level of kindness and care. You see, Christians are instructed to choose their words wisely. Christians are instructed to share a message in a way that builds up and encourages and has people to believe that by the power of the Holy Spirit, yes, they can, according to the word and the will of God. Amen, church? You see, we are not to be those who are constantly cutting down and tearing down with hands on our hips, mumbling under our breath about other people. But with grace and accountability, with kindness and intentional thoughtfulness, the words that we share and how we share them matter. Again, our theme verse that we've been looking at these last weeks, Ephesians 4:29. If you're there, listen again. Paul is writing, and he says, "Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for what? Building up, as fits the occasion, that it may give what? Grace to those who hear." So this morning, let's see what God's word has to say about how we would say God's word. Let's look at the positive, encouraging forms of communication that he calls us to. And if we're going to be encouraging, if we're going to build up with our words using the message of God, it begins, first of all, with praise. Say that with me. It begins with praise. Because people who spend a majority of their time praising their Father in heaven, right, they tend to be less critical. People who spend a healthy majority of their time praising their Father in heaven tend to be less critical in their choice of words and in their attitude and in how they express them. You see, those who praise God, they recognize who God is. When you are praising God, you are recognizing and recalling that He alone is holy, holy, holy. When you are busy praising God in the midst of His holiness, you're reminded of your own sinful disposition. Suddenly the focus turns to your own life and how we've given in to temptation and how we've borne out sin. When you're busy praising God, you praise Him for sending His one and only Son, Jesus Christ, who had to go all the way to the cross, who took our place when He was whipped. Those were whips intended for our backs to tear our flesh. Jesus shed His blood that we would be forgiven of our sins. Jesus sent us the one promised. He sent us the counselor. He sent us the encourager. He sent us the power of the Holy. Who? The Holy Spirit. People who are busy praising God tend to be less critical with their words and their language. In the book of Psalms, just listen to this verse a minute. Psalm 66, verse 17, he writes, "I cried to Him, I cried to God with my mouth, and high praise was on my tongue." If we're going to build people up, if we're going to encourage, it begins with praising God. remembering how he has encouraged, how he has built up, how he has redeemed and restored and reconciled our lives through the blood of Jesus Christ alone. Amen, church? We need to be a people of praise, not just on a Sunday, but we need to be a people of praise every day, because praise kills self-serving criticism. Praise prepares us to speak the truth in love. And immediately on the heels of praise comes the practice of number two, prayer. Say it with me, prayer. If we're going to speak words that encourage and words that build up, not words that are corrupt and putrid and rotting, if we're going to speak words that are edifying, then we need to begin from a place and a posture of prayer. Intentional, purposeful, contemplative prayer. And what are we praying for? Turn to Psalm 141, verse 3. That's page 619 in the Pew Bible, if you're using that. Page 619. Psalm 141, verse 3. There's a prayer that the psalmist is lifting up. And the prayer sounds like this. Set a guard, O Lord, over my... Are you there? What's it say? Mouth. Set a guard, O Lord, over my mouth. Keep watch over the door of my lips. It's praying. Lord, I want to speak your word. Lord, I want to edify. Lord, I want to encourage. Lord, I want to build up this individual's life. But Lord, I am praying that you set a guard over my mouth. Lord, if you need to put a bit in my mouth, Lord, if you need to pull my mouth back with your holy reins, Lord, keep a watch over the door of my lips. What I'm about to say, I want to speak clearly. I want to say your word. I don't want it to be filled with my opinion. I don't want it to be filled with my preferences. I don't want it to be filled with my will. Father, I am praying that you help me to share your word. One more from Proverbs 15, verse 28. Just listen to this. The heart of the righteous ponders how to answer, but the mouth of the wicked pours out evil things. It ponders. It prays. It meditates. It asks God. Loud lectures, fast-speaking, rambling, based upon opinions and feelings and mutterings and musings, that's all useful for Satan, and he uses it very well every single day. It's not useful for the kingdom of God. Before we say anything, Lord, I want it to be encouraging. Lord, I want it to be edifying. Lord, I want it to bring glory, and I want it to bring about a fruitfulness in this life. I want it to be a blessing. Lord, I pray and I ponder. Guard my mouth. Guard my lips. We praise God. We pray before we speak. Number three, we choose particular words. Say that with me. Particular words. You might even say prudent. The word that we're going to read in Scripture is prudent, so you can use prudent and particular interchangeably here. The words that we use matter. The words that we use matter. We need to choose the right words. We need to choose the right number of words. Prudent. Thinking about how this is going to affect things moving forward. Particular. Not thoughtless or emotionally driven or off the cuff. Prudent, particular, specific. Say it, and then be quiet. Would you repeat that with me? Say it and then be quiet. People have said that to me as a pastor. Thank you. Proverbs 10, verse 19 says this, when words are many, transgression is not lacking, but whoever restrains his lips is prudent. That's Proverbs 10, 19, if you're taking notes. Prudent, particular, specific, choosing words that encourage, choosing words that build up, choosing the right words, and then being quiet. You know, a lot of times we just get right in people's faces. Boom, 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 boom. They try to say something. Boom, 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 boom. I'm not done yet. I'm not done yet. I'm not done yet. You're going to listen to me. Boom, 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 boom. And we just keep going and going and going and going. And if they stop listening, we go to other people all about them. And we go. And you know what? That's not our job. We're called to speak the truth and love. We're called to speak words that encourage. We're called to speak words that build up. But when we start barraging, when we start attacking, when we start talking over, when we start rambling off without any rein on our mouths, we're trying to take the job of the Holy Spirit. We speak the truth in love, and then we let the Spirit do His job. Talking a lot, talking aloud, being mad, mumbling ongoingly, that's not of God. It's not helpful. That's not the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Talking a lot is not going to replace the work and the job of the Holy Spirit. Prudent, particular, specific words, say it and then be what? Quiet. Told you I don't like this series. I don't like that point either. Number four. Choose words that are positive. Say it with me. Words that are positive. This seems so simple. We're trying to inspire people to pursue God's holiness. You see, our encouragement, our desire to build them up, it's not because we want them to do what we want them to do. It's not about getting them to pursue our way. It's not about getting them to pursue our will. It's not about getting them to accept our opinion or to put a stamp of approval upon our preferences. But we're trying to get people to pursue God. We're trying to get people to pursue His Word, which contains His design and His plan, His unfolding will for our lives. And yet, in the midst of communicating all that, so often we do it in a negative way. Probably because it's the easiest. It's the lowest branch bearing fruit. It's easy. It's easy to get mad. It's easy to be negative. It's easy to give in to your emotions in the moment and then to storm off. Scripture calls us to choose language that is language that's positive with a heart that honestly matches it. You see, you have to have the heart that's godly. You have to have the heart filled with the Holy Spirit. You have to have the heart that contains that positive message, because the heart is the well from which come the words expressed with our mouths. Positive words. Proverbs 15, verse 4 says this, a gentle tongue. Another translation says a healing tongue. So a healing tongue is a tree of life. But perverseness in it breaks or crushes the spirit. In Ephesians 4, verse 15, we are told, speaking the truth in love, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ. Think about Jesus. You know him. You trust him as your Savior. You trust him as your Lord. You know the story of Jesus' earthly life. You've read and you've listened as Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John reflect on how Jesus spoke. We eavesdrop in on conversations that Jesus had with his disciples, that Jesus had as he was traveling down the road, in and out of certain communities all around the lake. And what we find over and over again is not Jesus using negative, brow-beating language. But what we find is Jesus using words that encourage, words that invite, words that edify, words that build up, words that speak of the kingdom of his Father in heaven. We hear Jesus using words intentionally that are positive, and he does it over and over again. Even when his disciples get it wrong, he again speaks positively. He speaks encouragingly into their lives. Can we make this really practical? What kind of a dad or what kind of a mom are you? When nobody else is in the house, when nobody else is around, what kind of words do you use with your children? I guarantee this, if you go home this afternoon and ask your children, do I use words with you that are negative, with negative emotion, or do I use words with you that are positive, that encourage you, that build you up? Our kids will be honest with us. We need to choose positive words. Number five, purifying words. Say that with me. Purifying words. Ultimately, we want people to pursue Jesus. A lot of times when we speak, it's because somebody has offended us. Somebody's made us mad. You know, there's a lot of people who are mad. There's a lot of people who are upset. There's a lot of people who feel as if they're not getting their way. They wouldn't do it that way. They're upset by that person who just cut me off on the road, right? There's a lot of that vitriol going around. And so a lot of the conversations that we have are in response to all of that. This life is not all about how people treat us or how people act around us. But this life has everything to do with those who are in sin and they don't know any better. And their relationship with God is broken. And they don't know the truth of Scripture. They have no idea that they're fearfully and wonderfully made, that they're created, and that they have a Father in heaven. They have no idea where sin came from or why temptation so pursues them in life. They have no idea that Jesus stands ready with arms extended in invitation, having already shed his blood for the forgiveness of their sins, if only they believe it in their heart and confess it with their mouth. That's why when it comes to speaking the truth in love, we choose words that purify. We stick to the words of Scripture. Colossians 4, verse 6, let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with, any idea what that next word is? Salt. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. You know, it's one of the qualities of salt. It purifies. We choose words that would speak to the pure, holy standards of God. We speak those words graciously, wanting to share God's answer, not ours. One more. Called to encourage, called to edify, called to build up. We need to speak words that call people to persevere. Would you say that with me, to persevere? You know what? There's enough bad news. There's enough bad news in this world. Most people are already discouraged about something. Most people already know where they're falling short. Most of us walk around with some kind of a target on our back representing our past life, and we feel like it identifies us, that it still identifies us. We feel as if we have failed at something. Or we have failed at multiple things. And having someone show up frown-faced, negative, is the last thing that person needs. Hebrews 10:25 calls us to be encouraging one another. Say that with me. Encouraging one another. And all the more as you see the day draw near. Speaking to the return of Christ. And it's speaking to those who are tired and who are weary. They already know the reality of their sin. It has already been identified for them. They know it in full. They don't need anybody else to rub their face in it and to tell them that they're too slow in the parade of sanctification. They know. They feel it every single day. And they feel more like a failure than a forgiven. What they need is somebody to come up alongside of them, put their arm around them, and encourage them to persevere. You see, that's what it is to be a part of the family of God. We bear one another's burdens. Shoulder to shoulder, we pursue Jesus. And with words that are encouraging and edifying and loving, we refuse to let anybody fall to the side. And none of us fight to be in first place. But we all fight to make known the name of our King and our Lord and our Savior, whose name is what? Jesus. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, help our words to be yours. What an opportunity we have. From the transformation of our hearts by the power of your Holy Spirit, what a message we have to give and to express. So help us to know what your word says. Help us to follow the lead of Jesus, refusing to leave any behind, encouraging, being encouraged, and pursuing the will of God for his glory alone. May it be. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Church, if you're able to stand, would you please do so? We have a living hope. And that is a living hope that we need to speak to and sing to and live out wherever we are and whatever God calls us to. And so into all those spaces and places and moments this week, go. And while you're there, share the love of God our Father. Share the grace and the forgiveness of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. And invite them to know the power and the healing of his Holy Spirit. As all God's people say, amen. God bless you, church.
Silence, the roaring lion declared the
wonderful week.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your bearer.